Penguin Random House Audio presents Start With Why, How Great Leaders Inspire Everyone to Take Action. Written and read by Simon Sinek.
There are leaders, and there are those who lead. Leaders hold a position of power or influence. Those who lead inspire us. Whether individuals or organizations, we follow those who lead not because we have to, but because we want to. We follow those who lead not for them, but for ourselves. This is a book for those who want to inspire others or for those who want to find someone to inspire them. Introduction. Why start with why? This book is about a naturally occurring pattern, a way of thinking, acting, and communicating that gives some leaders the ability to inspire those around them. Although these natural-born leaders may have come into the world with a predisposition to inspire, the ability is not reserved for them exclusively. We can all learn this pattern. With a little discipline, any leader or organization can inspire others, both inside and outside their organization, in order to help advance their ideas and their vision. We can all learn to lead. The goal of this book is not to simply try to fix the things that aren't working. Rather, I wrote this book as a guide to focus on and amplify the things that already work. I do not aim to upset the solutions offered by others. Most of the answers we get, when based on sound evidence, are perfectly valid. However, if we're starting with the wrong questions, if we don't understand the cause, then even the right answers will always steer us wrong eventually. The truth, you see, is always revealed eventually. The stories that follow are of those individuals and organizations that naturally embody this pattern. They are the ones that start with why. Section 1. The goal was ambitious. Public interest was high. Experts were eager to contribute. Money was readily available. Armed with every ingredient for success, Samuel Pierpont Langley set out in the early 1900s to be the first man to pilot an airplane. Highly regarded, he was a senior officer at the Smithsonian Institution, a mathematics professor who also had worked at Harvard. His friends included some of the most powerful men in government and business, including Andrew Carnegie and Alexander Graham Bell. Langley was given $50,000 from the War Department to fund his project, a tremendous amount of money for the time. He pulled together the best minds of the day, a veritable dream team of talent and know-how. Langley and his team used the finest materials, and the press followed them everywhere. People all over the country were riveted to this story, waiting to read that he had achieved his goal. With the team he had gathered and ample resources, his success was guaranteed. Or was it? A few hundred miles away, Wilbur and Orville Wright were working on their own flying machine. Their passion to fly was so intense that it inspired the enthusiasm and commitment of a dedicated group in their hometown of Dayton, Ohio. There was no funding for the venture, no government grants, no high-level connections. Not a single person on the team had an advanced degree or even a college education, not even Wilbur or Orville. But the team banded together in a humble bicycle shop and made their vision real. On December 17, 1903, a small group witnessed a man take flight for the first time in history. How did the Wright brothers succeed where a better equipped, better funded, and better educated team could not? It wasn't luck. Both the Wright brothers and Langley were highly motivated. Both had a strong work ethic. Both had keen scientific minds. They were pursuing exactly the same goal, but only the Wright brothers were able to inspire those around them and truly lead their team to develop a technology that would change the world. Only the Wright brothers started with why. Section 2. In 1965, students on the campus of UC Berkeley were the first to publicly burn their draft cards to protest America's involvement in the Vietnam War. Northern California was a hotbed of anti-government and anti-establishment sentiment. Footage of clashes and riots in Berkeley and in Oakland were beamed around the globe, fueling sympathetic movements across the United States and in Europe. But it wasn't until 1976, nearly 3 years after the end of America's military involvement in the Vietnam conflict, that a different revolution ignited. They aimed to make an impact, a very big impact, even challenge the way people perceived how the world worked. But these young revolutionaries did not throw stones or take up arms against an authoritarian regime. Instead, they decided to beat the system at its own game. For Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, the co-founders of Apple Computer, the battlefield was business, and the weapon of choice was the personal computer. The personal computer revolution was beginning to brew when Wozniak built the Apple I. Just starting to gain attention, the technology was primarily seen as a tool for business. Computers were too complicated and out of the price range of the average individual. But Wozniak, a man not motivated by money, envisioned a nobler purpose for the technology. He saw the personal computer as a way for the little man to take on the corporation. If he could figure out a way to get it in the hands of the individual, he thought, the computer would give nearly anyone the ability to perform many of the same functions as a vastly better resourced company. The personal computer could level the playing field and change the way the world operated. Woz designed the Apple I and improved the technology with the Apple II to be affordable and simple to use. No matter how visionary or how brilliant, a great idea or a great product isn't worth much if no one buys it. Wozniak's best friend at the time, the 21-year-old Steve Jobs, knew exactly what to do. Though he had experience selling surplus electronics parts, Jobs would prove to be much more than a good salesman. He wanted to do something significant in the world, and building a company was how he was going to do it. Apple was the tool he used to ignite his revolution. In their first year in business, with only one product, Apple made $1 million in revenues. By year two, they did $10 million in sales, and in their fourth year, they sold $100 million worth of computers. And in just 6 years, Apple Computer was a billion-dollar company with over 3,000 employees. Jobs and Woz were not the only people taking part in the personal computer revolution. They weren't the only smart guys in business. In fact, they didn't know much about business at all. What made Apple special was not their ability to build such a fast-growth company. It wasn't their ability to think differently about personal computers. What made Apple special is that they've been able to repeat the pattern over and over and over. Unlike any of their competitors, Apple has successfully challenged conventional thinking within the computer industry, the small electronics industry, the music industry, the mobile phone industry, and the broader entertainment industry. And the reason is simple. Apple inspires. Apple starts with why. Section 3. He was not perfect. He had his complexities. He was not the only one who suffered in a pre-civil rights America, and there were plenty of other charismatic speakers. But Martin Luther King Jr. had a gift. He knew how to inspire people. Dr. King knew that if the civil rights movement was to succeed, if there was to be a real, lasting change, it would take more than him and his closest allies. It would take more than rousing words and eloquent speeches. It would take people. Tens of thousands of average citizens united by a single vision to change the country. At 11 a.m. on August 28, 1963, they would send a message to Washington that it was time for America to steer a new course. The organizers of the civil rights movement did not send out thousands of invitations, nor was there a website to check the date. But the people came, and they kept coming and coming. All told, 250,000 people descended on the nation's capital in time to hear the words immortalized by history, delivered by the man who would lead a movement that would change America forever. I have a dream. The ability to attract so many people from across the country, of all colors and races, to join together on the right day, at the right time, took something special. Although others knew what had to change in America to bring about civil rights for all, it was Martin Luther King who was able to inspire a country to change not just for the good of a minority, but for the good of everyone. Martin Luther King started with why. There are leaders and there are those who lead. With only 6% market share in the United States and about 3% worldwide, Apple is not a leading manufacturer of home computers. Yet the company leads the computer industry and is now a leader in other industries as well. Martin Luther King's experiences were not unique, yet he inspired a nation to change. The Wright brothers were not the strongest contenders in the race to take the first manned-powered flight, but they led us into a new era of aviation, and in doing so, completely changed the world we live in. Their goals were not different from anyone else's, and their systems and processes were easily replicated. Yet the Wright brothers, Apple, and Martin Luther King stand out among their peers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.